we're on some kind of evolutionary schema. So for example, we need to challenge the idea that the development of queer theories in understanding gender nonconformity is merely a product of our own evolved, sophisticated analysis of gender and sexuality, that we just got smarter, we're just better than those other people. No, that's not how it happened. What happened was not some kind of march toward enlightenment, but rather a constant, uneven, complicated struggle against the mechanisms that make gendered inequalities, heteropatriarchy, heteronormative sexuality seem natural, organic, timeless. The processes of creating and reproducing the system of heteropatriarchy was a violent one. It was a violent process that even produced the system and intentionally masks histories that reveal that the so-called normative gender relations that we thought were always there were not always there. In most societies, what we think of as so-called normative gender relations are less than a century old. I mean, study Iran. I'm telling you, the idea that there's like two genders, that's modern. That's like less than 100 years. I mean, you have to go back and study the history to understand that. Inventing normativity is always a violent process. It requires policing. It requires a policing apparatus. And this is one of the many essential contributions that Beth Ritchie makes in her absolutely brilliant and stunning book, Arrested Justice. She writes about the state punishing norm violations such as adolescent pregnancy or any deviation from heterosexual nuclear families, right? She writes about the institutional regulations designed to intimidate people without power into conforming with dominant cultural expectations. For example, the idea that wage labor should replace the social safety net, like welfare reform. This neoliberal vision, in fact, was challenged by the very welfare activists that Pramila Nadasen writes about and challenged. Welfare activists actually expanded the welfare roles and insisted on a guaranteed annual income. And there are many other examples. The point is, one cannot separate some abstraction called power from gender and sexuality, from race and nationality, et cetera. So this brings up to the final issue, which is, what is the meaning of freedom? Freedom is not self-evident. It's not. In fact, the whole point of my talk is that nothing is self-evident, you know what I'm saying? You know? Before freedom dreams, we have to know what we mean by freedom. And for this, I turn again to my hero and dear colleague, Angela Davis, who stands against the liberal tradition that understands freedom as the right of the individual to do what he wishes without fetters or impediments, as long as it is lawful under the state. This negative liberty or freedom places a premium on the right to own property, accumulate wealth, to defend property by arms, mobility, expression, and political participation. That's like the Hobbesian, you know, notion of freedom. But Davis's conception of freedom is far more expansive and radical. Collective freedom, the freedom to earn a livelihood and live a healthy, fully realized life, freedom from violence, sexual freedom, social justice, abolition of all forms of bondage and incarceration, freedom from exploitation, freedom of movement, freedom as movement, as collective striving for real democracy. For Davis, freedom is not a thing granted by the state in the form of law or proclamation or policy. Freedom is struggled for. It is hard fought. It is transformative, and it is a participatory process that demands new ways of thinking and being. So finally, Barbara asked me what I thought about the quilt as a metaphor, and it's powerful. Though I want to suggest something different from the way we typically see the scraps and patches of color as metaphor for solidarity across difference and unity within difference, or communities reorganized to create new patterns and new possibilities. Instead, I want us to think in terms of the threads. okay, in terms of the processes that produce these pieces of cloth in the first place. The largely female and perhaps child labor in the garment industry, who worked or even manufactured the electric looms, picked cotton, either driving mechanical cotton pickers or by hand in China, India, Pakistan, Turkey, Brazil, and yes, the US South, the second largest producer of cotton still. In this neoliberal world, where creative destruction and privatization and immiseration is the order of the day, I hope we can imagine all the hands and eyes and minds that went into the quilt and went into picking cotton and turning it into thread, to recognize that how we are connected across the globe, that in order to realize our freedom dreams, there's a lot of work we have to do to dismantle not only the system, but its logics. Thank you.
Thank you for your remarks, Dr. Kelly. Now I am honored to introduce Angela Davis, whose work has inspired so many of us on our activist journeys and has helped to push our radical politics even further. In works like Abolition Democracy and Are Prisons Obsolete, Angela pushes conceptual boundaries around the type of society we can imagine as possible and encourages us to see that our movements and struggles are interconnected. A quote from Abolition Democracy that frames well the themes of this conference and her activist background is, "What we manage to do each time we win a victory is not so much to secure change once and for all, but rather to create new terrains for struggle." Angela is an educator who has always emphasized the importance of building communities of struggle for economic, racial, and gender justice. Please welcome Angela Davis to the stage.
Wow, it's really wonderful to see all of you gathered here this evening. And let me first acknowledge that this conference takes place on colonized land. And one of my freedom dreams is that we all develop what food justice activists call a deep sense of place. A deep sense of place. Robin talked about deep thought, and that's going to be one of the themes of my remarks as well. So that whatever we do, we never allow ourselves to forget the lasting effects of settler colonialism and its genocidal violence on the original inhabitants of this land. I was also really moved by the poets who preceded us. Thank you so much for your work. Thank you so much. And I want to pay tribute also to some of our comrades who have recently passed away, Stuart Hall and Amiri Baraka, and of course, Vincent Harding, Maya Angelou, and Chokwe Lumumba, and all of the other comrades who've passed on. Robin mentioned Jane Cortez, and I saw the photograph of June Jordan. Was a photograph of me with June Jordan, and I cannot believe that she has been gone so long, but her spirit is still with us. I just met Karen Lewis in person. And I was telling her how excited I was. You know, I followed her on television, and last time I was in Chicago, I spoke about her. So this is really great. Mm-hmm. I want to thank Barbara Ransby and all of the members of the organizing committee who made this phenomenal gathering possible. You had an amazing vision, bringing activists together across generations, across what Barbara calls parallel worlds of activism, and across multiple concerns of these activisms, bringing us all together to look backwards in order to look forwards, in order to look forward toward new possibilities. That is to say, what some would consider impossible futures. And so now is the time to dream about impossible futures, about the conditions of possibility for the impossible. This is a very important historical conjuncture, and I use the word conjuncture as a nod towards Stuart Hall. If one looks at the rise of activisms, prison abolitionist activism, anti-capitalist activism, campaigns against heteropatriarchy, homophobia, transphobia, and the new energy we see in the struggles for Palestine solidarity. I am immensely honored by the fact that I've been asked to share this stage with Robin Kelly. I've known Robin since he was a graduate student. and of course, his fabulous book, Freedom Dreams, together with the SNCC slogan, Freedom Now, provides the thematic coherence of this conference. This is the third time Robin and I, as he said, have been on the same stage this month. The third time this month. And we're also going to be speaking together in about 10 days. When the African American Studies Department graduation happens. So I've been thinking that there must be some message to be detected in the fact that we've spoken together publicly four times during the course of a month. We have to talk about that, Robin. Last week we spoke, was that just last week? Yeah, it was last week. We spoke at an event that was organized by Students for Justice for Palestine on the UCLA campus the week before. I spoke in the same venue where I gave the very first lecture of my academic career as a just fired assistant professor of philosophy. And we had a panel that included Robin Kelly, Cheryl Harris, and Rachel Herzing from Critical Resistance. And I can tell you that as I was speaking in Royce Hall, after being introduced by the current chancellor of UCLA, I was thinking that if you stay around long enough, if you are persistent long enough, you will be embraced by the very institution that banished you. But precisely at the moment when I felt that I was being embraced, I realized I had to think about how to extricate myself from the embrace of this institution. Even as I recognized that it was a major victory of our struggle. So I absolutely love Robin's work. And I've been following, as I said, I've been following him since before he wrote his first book, before he wrote his dissertation, as a matter of fact. And I want to thank him publicly for providing the introduction, which I think is certainly the best part of the collection of talks published under the title, The Meaning of Freedom. And let me also say that Freedom Dreams is one of my most favorite works of all time. It has been 50 years since Freedom Summer. Since one of the most electrifying social justice experiments in our history, perhaps the only one that was more important, was radical reconstruction. Young people, students and workers of my generation answered the call to participate in that amazing campaign in Mississippi. And remember, there was no Facebook in those days. So. As a matter of fact, had there been social media, I would have heard about it in Europe and I would have come home sooner. How slowly news traveled then, but how quickly young people responded to the call to travel to Mississippi in order to change the world. Because that is what that campaign was about. I know that you have spent the last couple of days reflecting on that time and collectively imagining how we can turn our collective historical memory of that amazing moment into inspiration for our freedom dreams today, into an impetus to imagine ways of moving along new trajectories of liberation. One of the original architects of Freedom Summer, Bob Moses, has not given up. 50 years later, he is still running the Algebra Project, which brings mathematics to youth of color who live in impoverished community. And that is the way he chose to continue that struggle for freedom. I think it's important for us to recognize that there's not just one way. There are many ways. And Bob is passionate about mathematics. I've had conversations with him. And, you know, I mean, it's hard for me to understand that passion. But I witness it. And I think I understand why he made that choice. And all of us have to think in terms of passions that will allow us to continue to move along those trajectories indefinitely. And Bob encourages us to think deeply about the individualism that infects us, especially in this era of neoliberalism, to recognize that the individualism, the heroic individualism that is most frequently evoked as the motor of the mid-20th century freedom movement. We have these a few individuals, mostly, I mean, it tends to be male. The heroic individual is always gendered as male. And this process, individuals are the agents of history, that heroic individuals are the agents of history is a major impediment to understanding the extraordinary power of ordinary human beings. Ordinary human beings, when they come together, and most importantly, when they imagine together and when they struggle together. We have been asked to reflect on the collective imagination, collective energy, and collective perseverance that brought down the laws of segregation and made it possible for black people to exercise the civil rights that should have been accorded to us when slavery was abolished. And that's why we have to recognize that movement as the continuation of the abolitionist movement. As a matter of fact, instead of the civil rights movement, we might call it the 20th century abolitionist movement. We are also asked to harness the inspiration we experience when we revisit that moment 50 years ago, in order to recognize that we can imagine, we can dream, we can struggle. The nitty-gritty practice of politics often requires us to engage in compromise. And those of us who know anything at all about politics, we understand the importance of compromise. But there are times when compromise equals capitulation. Yeah. And we should always remind ourselves that our dreams do not have to bear the imprint of compromise. During the summer of 1964, when Fannie Lou Hamer demanded that the Mississippi Freedom Democratic Party be seated at the Democratic Party convention, instead of the delegation being seated, and of course it would have taken the place of the white supremacist Democratic Party delegation, the Mississippi Freedom Democratic Party delegation was offered 2 seats. And so Fannie Lou Hamer, who many people witnessed giving this impassioned speech about the importance of voting rights and representation on television, she said, "We didn't come all this way for no 2 seats. Because all of us is tired. We didn't come all this way for no 2 seats. They were demanding equality, and what was being offered to them was 2 seats. So 2 seats did not even begin to put us on the road to equality. Those struggles that came out of Freedom Summer inspired students at UC Berkeley to organize the free speech movement. And I'm thinking about Bettina Apteka and Mario Savio. I really love what Mario Savio said during one of his speeches on Sproul Plaza, inspired by what had happened during Freedom Summer in Mississippi and other parts of the South. He said, "There's a time when the operation of the machine becomes so odious, makes you so sick at heart that you can't take part. You can't even passively take part. And you've got to put your bodies upon the gears and upon the wheels, upon the levers, upon all the apparatus, and you've got to make it stop. You've got to make it stop." And I think that reflects the spirit of that era. And we should recognize what it meant for young people all over the country to feel drawn to that project in Mississippi, to decide to spend their vacation facing the Ku Klux Klan. They knew exactly what they were facing. And of course, they experienced the violence that led to the murder of two of the young men who had come down, and you know, one young man who lived in Mississippi. Now, we've learned a great deal since that period. We've learned how to envision struggles for racial justice very broadly. We know that struggles for racial justice are not only for people of African descent, but of Asian, Latin American, Middle Eastern descent. We know that anti-Muslim racism is one of the most virulent forms of contemporary racism. And we know that all of these racisms are rooted in the genocide of colonization inflicted on indigenous people. So we think broadly, and we think deeply. We didn't actually decide to make thinking deeply the themes of our remarks. But this is what is required today. And as I said earlier, we always need a deep sense of our struggle so that we don't make the mistake of assuming that we start right now, as if we today produce the only histories that matter. You know, I was reading a really interesting an anthology by Alkan and Ajiman on food justice and sustainability. And in one of the articles, there's a description of a young woman who is this really impassioned vegan, impassioned organic farmer. And she talks about decreasing her footprint, her carbon footprint. And then someone asked her, well, do you know anything about the farming practices of the native people in this area? And her response was, I know organic farmers, but I don't think I know any Indian farmers. Absolutely no sense. But also, no sense. No sense. Because in order to have sense, you have to have deep sense. Deep sense. And I can't deviate from my notes too much because I only have a few. I have a few more minutes left. Oh wow. Okay. And this sense of ourselves as individuals, she was only concerned with her own individual footprint. And in the process, she was replicating the very individualism that neoliberalism uses to prevent us from imagining ourselves as communities, as collectives, as empowered people. So how long have black people raised the slogan of 40 acres and a mule? I mean, we've been talking about getting our 40 acres and a mule for, the last 150 years, right? But why did we not learn how to question the legitimacy of claiming land that belonged to someone else? So whose 40 acres were they to begin with? And so as we move forward, we have to look backward. And therefore demands for reparations, and Robin has a really wonderful history of the reparations movement in Freedom Dreams, in the chapter that's called Day of Reckoning, Dreams of Reparation. But demands for reparation will have to rest on a deep awareness of settler colonialism and on its foundational role in the production of U.S. democracy. We've been urged by Barbara and the Planning Committee to think about what they call the four P's. Prisons, as in prison industrial complex, poverty, as in produced by capitalism, patriarchy, as in heteropatriarchy, and Palestine, as in the contemporary struggle against apartheid and settler colonialism. We've been urged to think deeply about these modes of oppression and repression, and I think the alliterative associations of the four P's are designed to encourage us to think about their deeper structural linkages and how they coincide and overlap and intersect. How do we think together prisons, poverty, patriarchy, and Palestine, and how can our freedom dreams reflect a capacity to think complexly, as well as how to our capacity rather to popularize complicated analyses. Complicated analyses are not only or primarily for the academic. As a matter of fact, oftentimes what academics assume to be complicated analyses are actually really simple. But we need complexity. We need complexity, and we need to be able to figure out oftentimes how to translate that complexity, how to make that complexity accessible. And so prisons. So I have a last section that's prisons, poverty, patriarchy, and Palestine. Prisons. There was a New York Times editorial on the 24th of this month on mass incarceration. And I guess most of you saw the editorial, right? Right? And so the editorial concludes this way: the research is in, and it is incontestable. The American experiment in mass incarceration has been a moral, legal, social, and economic disaster. It cannot end soon enough. Okay, that's the New York Times. And they are really just playing catch up. You know. I mean, I don't know why we get so happy when the New York Times comes up with an editorial like that. It's like they came up with the idea in the first place. They didn't. We've been talking about this for decades. But I think it is important that they feel obligated now to admit it. But it's not so simple, because it's not only about prisons in the U.S. It's not only about, and I think the term mass incarceration is important and has led to a great deal of organizing. But we have to go further than that. It's not just about putting a lot of people in prison. You know, it's about a whole system, and this is why we attempted to introduce the term prison industrial complex so that we could think in a more complicated way about the work that prisons do, not only in the U.S., but all over the country, throughout the global north, but also increasingly in the global south as a direct inheritor of structural adjustment. And of course, the connection with immigration policies and practices, with, you know, violent repression against immigrants, not only here, but in Europe, and also in Africa. And as a matter of fact, as many of you know, the private prison corporations have made it very clear that they consider immigrant detention as the most profitable sector of private prisons. And so we have to think about the question of prisons in a much more complicated way. And I brought this book up that just came off the presses, and I see one of the editors, Liat Ben Moshe, I just saw you. Where did I see you? Oh, right there. Yeah, I just saw you. Is here, and many of you heard her yesterday. But this anthology helps us to think about the work of the prison, the work of incarceration, in an even more complicated framework. And we see how the incarceration of disabled people over the decades and centuries has actually helped to shape the way in which incarceration functions in the in a larger context in the U.S. and throughout the world. So it's only $25, and I think there are a few left. So you better hurry if you want to get one of the very first copies of this amazing anthology. This is about complicating our analysis and not being satisfied with the way in which our work is given back to us. It's given back to us in a certain way by the New York Times, and we are invited to celebrate that. What we have to do instead is to strategize where we go from here. Patriarchy. No, I miss poverty. Poverty. And in terms of poverty, I wanted to talk about the promise of the Occupy movement. I think it's so important for those of us who are serious about changing the world to use the promises of certain historical conjunctures. Those promises do not have to go away, even though the moment is past. The promise of radical reconstruction is still with us today. The promise of Occupy resides in the fact that for the first time since perhaps the 1930s, we were allowed to propose open critiques of capitalism. And let's not forget that. If we cannot bring critiques of capitalism into our work, our scholarly work, our activist work, then we will be forever under the spell of this system that thrives on exploitation and racism and patriarchy. And speaking of patriarchy, let me say that I was recently reading Angela Harris's article, which is called Heteropatriarchy Kills. And she focuses largely on sexual violence in men's prisons and the production of what Terry Kupas calls toxic masculinities. And reading that work, I thought about an experience I recently had at the University of Southern Illinois Carbondale, speaking with a group of young black men who are students there. First of all, I didn't realize that there are more black students at the University of Southern Illinois than there are at most HBCUs. Because it's like, what is it, about 40% black, the population of the university? And so this group of young men created this organization called Progressive Masculinities. And this group of young black men who are trying to learn how to be men in a very different way. And what they do is they work at the Women's Center. They do rape crisis work. They are involved in a major campaign against sexual assault. And it occurred to me that some years ago, the promise for this kind of activism could be seen in an organization in DC that emerged around the same time as what was the first black, Beverly knows, anti-rape organization in the country. It was in DC, that Loretta. Oh, yeah. DC Rape Crisis, exactly. And around that time, a group of black men in DC decided that they would also take on the task of confronting sexual violence. This was back in the 70s. And so one would have thought that by the 21st century, there would be huge numbers of men engaging in the work of eradicating sexual violence. But that hasn't happened. And so I see these young men in Carbondale, and I promised them that I would talk about them, planting ideas in other geographical spaces, they are the promise that we witnessed in the early 70s. Now, Palestine, the last P, Palestine. It seems to me that our goal today has to be to incorporate Palestine into every progressive and radical social justice agenda in the country. That is what we have to do. Just as the eyes of the world, all of the eyes of the world were once focused on South Africa, they should be focused on Palestine today. We who believe in freedom should not rest. And certainly we cannot rest as long as Israel engages with impunity in the repression of Palestinian people and remains the only settler colonial state in the world that continues to expand. That is trying to expand. And here in Chicago, we need to be thinking about Razmiya. And you know that she received, Razmiya Youssef O'Day received the Outstanding Leader Award. And less than a year ago, she was arrested by Homeland Security agents, charged with unlawful procurement. Can you imagine what she unlawfully procured? Unlawful procurement of naturalization. Unlawful procurement of nationalization. And this is because she failed to explain on her application that she had been arrested. That she had been arrested by the Israeli government and that she had been tortured. And hearings are happening now in Detroit. They moved the case to Detroit precisely because of the fact that there's a huge community here in Chicago. So one of the tasks confronting us is to make sure that that community is remade in Detroit, whether it means people traveling to Detroit or doing organizing in Detroit to guarantee that every time she goes to court, the courtroom is full. And in general, we have to learn how to stand up and overcome the fear of being targeted if we speak out. As long as we allow that fear to immobilize us, we will continue to be targeted when we speak out. So we have to learn how to stop engaging in self-censure. I think that's a major task today. So let me wind up. I know I've gone over time. Barbara wrote to Robin and me. She said, why are freedom dreams so important as we continue to engage in the concrete work of response and resistance to oppression? I am assuming that you will both mention prisons, Palestine, poverty, and patriarchy. But if you had a room full of 500 activists in front of you looking for a deeper analysis and greater sense of connection to one another, what would you say? Okay. So I thought about that, and I was actually quite surprised that my thoughts almost instinctively focused on a very early period of my life when I was not yet 20. When I was a burgeoning activist. I had this thirst to think beyond my own circumstances. I wanted to know about much more than what I had directly experienced in Birmingham, Alabama, in New York, in Boston. So I went, you know, I left Birmingham and I went to New York, I went to the Northeast, and then I went to France. And in France, I made contact with Algerian activists. And I came to embrace the Algerian Revolution. And from there, the larger continent of Africa, and then Asia, and then Latin America, and then the world. And so my dreams are now that we extricate ourselves from our self-imposed provincialism. My dreams are about a deeper consciousness. They are about transforming the way we think about ourselves and each other. They are about extricating ourselves from the US-centric provincialism which imprisons us. They are about creating new habits of consciousness. They are freedom dreams about making connections across worlds. Thank you very much.
Wow. We invited Angela Davis and Robin Kelly to be a part of this final plenary because their work has inspired us and in fact inspired the very conception of this conference because they are not only freedom dreamers but freedom fighters. I wouldn't be a proper daughter of Ella. We have a network of Ella's daughters here. I wouldn't be an Ella's daughter if I allowed my name to be mentioned from this podium without also saying there was enormous work that went into putting this gathering together, and Emily, on the behalf of both of us, named some of those people. But I want to thank all of you for coming out, and I want to thank all the volunteers and people who stayed up late and got up early in order to bring us all here together, all of you very busy people. So I just want to give a round of applause to our partners, our co-sponsors, our volunteers, and the SJI team. I also want to say a special thanks to the artists, to Malcolm and Sage and Jasmine, who started us off with such powerful and moving words, to the photographs that are around the room, our people's photographer, Sarah Jane Ree, here in Chicago, has documented struggle after struggle in Chicago, from people who sat in enclosed to people who fought evictions, to the heroic Chicago teachers' strike, to the anti-NATO protests. Sarah Jane came and took those photographs to remind us of all the small and large struggles that comprise the freedom movement that is ongoing. It is not just in history and in memory. I also want to thank the quilters. Some of you participated in the quilting process, and Robin challenged us to deepen our understanding of what political quilting might mean and looking at both the fiber and the threads. But Mary Scott Boria and Gail Mitchell and Georgette Sinkler anchored that table there, really doing the hard, tactile work of creating a quilt. And one of the things that we promise all of you is that when that quilt is assembled, we will share it with this community. It may travel. We will certainly post it on our website. But I want to thank Mary and Georgette and the other quilters for this conference has been three very full days of talking, sharing, thinking, and rethinking issues related to freedom and justice. In the call for freedom dreams and freedom now, we ask the question, what language do we have that reflects the kind of world we want to live in? In session after session, in plenary after plenary, from over 200 speakers, artists, organizers, activists, we were prodded, provoked, inspired, and ignited. With the presentations tonight, hopefully, our radical imaginations are on fire and in motion. I want to now tell you a special treat that we have for you. that in addition to a conversation with Robin Kelly and Angela Davis, as if that is not exciting enough, we have invited Karen Lewis, the fierce and fabulous leader of our movement union, to join us in a conversation about freedom and justice. One artist I didn't acknowledge is Fahim Majid, who had the sculptures, the soap boxes that were outside that some of you sat on, and here we have as a part of the stage construction today. And it just reminds us of what art does for us when we don't even notice it, right? So what art does for us when we don't even notice it, it has become a part of our gathering here. It provided sustenance for people outside as they sat and had conversations and so forth. So thanks to Fahim. So I'm only gonna ask a couple of questions, and then I promise you there'll be time for questions from the audience. We can't stay here all night, but we will allow for some questions and interactions with the audience. I guess that, you know, everybody talked about their freedom dreams, and maybe I'll start with you, Karen, since you just joined us. You know, we watched the teacher strike unfold, and we all felt inspired by it. And even if we weren't a part of it, we felt a part of it, right? And we claimed it. So when you think, and part of it is because it was bigger than a bread and butter set of demands, right? So when you think of your freedom dreams as an educator, as a labor leader, what does that look like?
Wow, okay, thank you, first of all, thank you for letting me even breathe this air, okay? Because I have to tell you, I'm a little verklempt, I'm a little, you know, it's Angela Davis. You all don't understand, this is my childhood reliving, you know, I had the fro, I had the power, you know, I had it all. Kenwood High School, you know, Bronco love. So the Broncos in the house, that's what I'm talking about. Oh, there you go. So my freedom dream is that teaching continues to be a political act, and that we resist any attempt to take politics out of the classroom. I think people... because the move is to standardize speech, to standardize the way children are taught, to the point where their humanity does not matter. And the people that are in the process of doing this have said this out loud. It's not like they're keeping it a secret. It's not like any of this is subterranean. And they go to Twitter and Facebook too, and they put that over. So for me, freedom is going to continue to mean that we have to have a space where truth can be told, real conversations can be had, no matter how uncomfortable it makes us. And real freedom should make someone else uncomfortable.
I want to ask Robin and Angela to elaborate on some of their freedom dreams. And we talked a lot about looking back in order to look forward. But when I think about both of your political careers as freedom dreamers and freedom activists, as scholars and thinkers, they have evolved over time from Hammer and Hoe and Women, Race, and Class, if we talk about your publications, to issues you're speaking out about today and you're passionate about today. So our experience and struggle changes and transforms us. How have you been transformed by your praxis over the last number of years, and how have your freedom dreams evolved?
Yeah. Oh, yeah, got their own. They got their own mic. It's not on, though.
How's that? Scare me. Okay, well, I guess I'll go first because I'd love to hear what Angela has to say. First of all, I'm transformed by the moment. I mean, every moment. Like, this moment right now, it's like, I want to talk about schools. Like, that's what I actually would like to talk about. I think that, I guess for me, it's the conditions, the fact that the world keeps changing, and the world keeps changing in large part because of struggle. You know, think about how many victories were won that produced the movements. Like, for example, just take one example. In the 1990s, so many of the organizations that were really essential, from Sister to Sister and Power and all these different organizations, they came out in opposition to Bill Clinton's policies, his welfare reform, his attack on public housing. I mean, there's a whole list of things. So the 90s was a period of vibrant struggle where people connected welfare reform with the attacks on schools. And then you've got the whole question of the Bush agenda, which comes also out of the Clinton agenda, of really defunding and not just defunding schools, but turning schools into these militarized zones, moving the criminal justice system in and producing military people, you know, recruitment for the army in what has essentially been the longest wars in U.S. history, right? So in some ways, the conditions themselves and then the movements themselves shape me. I mean, I've been very, very fortunate to, you know, have this job as an academic. And I know someone dissed me on Twitter, said I'd use jargon. Well, it's cool, you know. But
who was that?
I don't know who it was. But it was when I was, you know, I do more than one thing at once. You know, I have peripheral vision. So, but this thing about being an academic, everything I learned, I didn't learn in the classroom. I learned by my relationships with movements. That's why I know so many people, because, and the people that I meet in these movements are very much organic intellectuals whose understanding of the world informs mine. So my relationship to these movements, I have a whole list I could go into. Domestic Workers United, for example. I mean, I learned so many from those women, so much, which is now Domestic Workers Alliance. I mean, that I just feel like it has been my training. So that, for me, has kind of moved me through different kinds of struggles and different perspectives. And I'm so happy that, on one hand, I'm happy it's not over. On the other hand, I mean, it's come to a point where, you know, you just want to win, but we know that it's protracted. It never ends.
Okay. Well, it's yeah. Your mic is fine. I don't mind yours. So. Karen, when you were talking about politics in the classroom, I was remembering that I think it was last week I had dinner at UCLA. I've been at UCLA, so it's about, you know, returning. I'm teaching a graduate seminar there. So I got to have lunch with faculty in the philosophy department, which was my first department, right? And there was one person who was still there. And so he told me that there was a point when he was asked by the chancellor to sit in on my classes to determine whether I brought politics into the classroom. And he was supposed to take notes. And
the answer was yes.
Yeah, the answer was yes. But he reminded me that I had said to the students, everybody knows my politics. And you have a lot of professors. They don't reveal what their politics are, yet the way they teach, what they teach, how they teach is so informed by their politics. But the question, have I been changed? Yeah, I've changed so much. I change from week to week. And I mean, I've changed a lot because there's so many things that I didn't know. And now I know that there's so many more things that I don't know. And so therefore, I change when I'm able to learn from others who have different perspectives. And I'll just give you one example, because I could, you know, go on and on about this. But I used to think that in order to be a good activist, you had to devote every single minute of the day. And that you had to sleep no more than 3 hours a night, Robin. And that if you got caught doing something like, I don't know, painting your fingernails or something like that, you know, that was bourgeois. And I eventually learned that self-care is really important. I mean, it's even more important for people who imagine themselves as activists, who want to have a long life doing this work. There's no way you can do it if you burn yourself out in a 1 year or 5 years or even 10 years. You have to figure out, you know, how to do it. And you may do it differently. You may not do it the same way all the time, and that's fine. You know, you may decide, oh, I want to do this as an artist now. And you become an artist. I have a friend, Linda Burnham may be in the house. I don't know if you hear Linda, but her mom decided, how old was she? Maybe when she was in her 70s when she decided she wanted to be an artist. And now she is 99. And she's had this amazing career as an artist, but she is deeply, passionately concerned about social justice. And we have to do it in ways that reflect our own passions. We can't do it because someone else tells us to do it that way. And while we're doing it, we have to learn how to, you know, do what we need to do. We have to learn how to eat consciously. You know, I'm not saying don't eat meat and stuff like that. I'm saying eat consciously. Understand the implications of the practice of eating. And we have to take care of our bodies and take care of our spirits and you know, cultivate that in ourselves that will allow us to be the very best we can possibly be, not as an individual, but always in relation to our communities and to the process of building communities of struggle.
So just a couple more questions from me, and then you all get ready. So the process of struggle often informs where we end up. So when we talk about freedom dreams, we also have to talk about tools and tactics. And when Angela was recalling Mario Savio and quoting from him, I was sitting next to Karen, and Karen said, "Sounds like a general strike to me." So I'm wondering, when we think of the tools and tactics that will and are changing the world and that we need to embrace, what kind of tools and tactics do you think about? There's a lot of cyber organizing. We had a panel on technology. Of course, culture plays a role. Strikes play a role. You know, various kinds of protests that we engage in here and, you know, with stakes higher in other parts of the world. What kind of tactics and tools do we need for transformative justice?
Well, I think we need to throw a monkey wrench into the works, okay? So I think that right now, what are the means of oppression? And in schooling, the means of oppression are centered around the test and punish regime. So I think it is imperative that we have conversations with our parents about opting out of standardized testing so that our children are not labeled or ranked or sorted or put into categories that determine their pathways. I think people haven't thought about this. We're seeing small groups of affluent parents saying, you are making my children ill, okay? But what we're not looking at is large groups of persons of color who are saying, you are ranking and sorting my children and continuing a form of oppression. So I think that the massive concept around a massive opt-out movement, that time has come, because we can choke the means of oppression, which are the data that these people are driven by. I don't mind being data informed. That's important. You need to be informed by data, but you should not be driven by data, because that's the crazy train. And we don't need to be on that.
Yeah, and Garfield High School, they opted out, right?
The teachers
boycotted. Okay. Well, you know, it's a great question. Of course, tactically, I don't think any particular strategy should just sort of be taken off the table. Like, it depends on time, place, condition. I mean, Jackson, Mississippi is a great example in which a local movement could produce a local democracy, and with all the difficulties of governing, govern. I think the Bus Riders Union in Los Angeles has used a tactic that involved mass protests, demonstrations, organizing on the buses, but also a legal strategy of getting a consent decree. The one example I want to give, a very successful example of student organizing, is a community rights campaign in Los Angeles. I don't know if you're familiar with the community rights campaign. Well, in cities all over the country, as we all know, the police and criminal justice system basically have invaded the campuses, and they run things. And so in LA, after the rebellion in 1992, they passed a daytime curfew law in 1995 that basically allowed the police and the LA school police to give citation, to arrest, to harass kids, mostly kids of color, in junior high schools. They were getting citations that could be as much as $200 and $250 for working class, some of whom are undocumented kids who have to go downtown to attend to the ticket. Their parents have to accompany them, which meant that they had to lose a day of work, and they couldn't afford the tickets. And sometimes three tickets could be $1,000, and kids were being suspended, and they were getting tickets for being late to school. They're on their way to school, and they're walking to campus, and the police are out there giving them tickets as they go into the school. So, to give you the example of strategies, so the Community Rights Campaign basically, through the Labor Community Strategy Center, did all this enormous research to locate exactly what schools are being targeted, what neighborhoods, what people, like, they found statistics that 16,000 plus tickets were given by the LA school police. Not a single one went to a white kid. Not a single one. They can't even get one, you know? And of the 34,000 tickets and they were getting tickets for things like having things that are legal, like having big Sharpies. And like the big Sharpies, because they said, well, you must be doing graffiti. I mean, things like that. So to make a long story short, they combined their research, they produced these amazing documents that mapped out the repression. Then they distributed these documents, they did radio, they did interviews, then they went to the city council and every week would protest and say, look at what's happening. The media campaign, the protest campaign, the after school campaign, where they actually brought kids into this organization, they were able to force the city council to dramatically change the law to where those $200 tickets are now $20. And where not only they're $20, but you can get three warnings before you even are ticketed. And most importantly, they have I think it's an hour or an hour and a half grace period where you can be late to school. Because what happened was kids were not going to school because they were late, right? So those kids won. And they won because they used every strategy possible, and one of the most important strategies was knowledge production. I mean, they couldn't have won and persuaded the city council without actually doing the research to figure out what the situation was. So to me, that's a great, great example of a victory.
Yeah, I agree that that the actual tactics one might use at a certain moment is going to have to reflect the state of organizing. And I think oftentimes we skip over, you know, that moment, and we don't recognize the importance of organizing. And certainly Karen knows that the organizing is the very heart of the labor movement. If you don't organize a community, then you can't go anywhere. And I say this because in the era of technologically advanced communication, we often assume that all we have to do is get in touch, right? And we can do that, you know, we can do that through Twitter, we can do it through Facebook, we can, if we want a demonstration, all we have to do is, you know, yes, mass text or, you know, Facebook it, and we will have a demonstration tomorrow. But that does not indicate that there is a community of people who, you know, feel close, a kind of emotional closeness to each other and to the causes that they are coming together around. And in my talk, I was referring to the need to, you know, broaden our sense of who we are and our connections with people in other parts of the world. And it's hard for most people now to think beyond their neighborhoods. And so how can we build communities? I think that, to me, that's the issue. And then we can use, you know, all kinds of really effective strategies and tactics. I happen to think that BDS is really important. Boycott is really important, because that's, in a sense, you were talking about boycotting the standardized exams. And divestment is really important. And bringing together other issues, so bringing together the whole movement against fossil fuels, the whole movement against private prisons, and divestment from corporations that are involved in the occupation of Palestine. I have to say that you know, I'm really impressed by work that young activists are doing. And I don't know why so many people talk about young people as if, you know, why aren't they doing what, I mean, I think they may be looking for other things. They're looking for themselves when they were that age, and they don't see themselves when they were that age. So they assume young people aren't doing anything. But at Robin and I did this, another event at UCLA. This was another one around the film. And so afterwards, I met with a group of young students. It was in the dorms, black students, primarily. And at first they said they had told me they wanted to do a reception. So I figured, okay, you know, food and people doing small talk and so forth. But those students had a circle. And the issue they raised immediately was that we were able to get the resolution around the private prison divestment passed by the student government. Okay, but they said we were not able to get the resolution about Palestine passed. So how do we use our victory around privatization of prisons to enable us to pass the resolution calling for divestment of corporations that are involved in the occupation of Palestine? And I said, you know, black students at UCLA are happening. You know, there was, I sat there in amazement. And they had all the information, and they had decided they were going to do this, and they, those kinds of tactics actually do work.
Angela, you talked about building community as a really important part of the work, and then to raise up this question of young people and the work that they're doing. I think also there's challenges around intergenerational work, and I want to ask you, I think about Ella Baker's example, and she is a good example of doing intergenerational work. I wanted to ask all three of you about what you think the challenges are, or things we need to remember, things we get wrong when we try to do intergenerational work. One is underestimating young people, but what are some of the other things that we, and how many, somebody asked this question earlier, I'm really happy that there are a lot of young people. How many people under 25 in the room? Yeah.
Nice.
Yeah. That's good. We need you. So what about that question?
So I have the privilege of being usually the oldest person in the room with the people I work with.
We got you beat tonight.
I know, thank God. But so I remember we basically went into office on a Thursday, and we were whisked off to Seattle to the AFT National Convention, and we literally had no clue of how to start anything. But what this woman said to me is, how do you have all these young people in your union that are active? And the question is, you have to give space for that. You know, I mean, that's all that, you have to move out of the way. It's just very simple. It's not hard. And frankly, I had no business in it. They recruited me. They came after me. And I was like very reluctant to do all of this work because I felt like it was my turn to retire and sit down and let, because I have to admit I'm a little bitter because I was supposed to retire last year, just for the record. That was my plan. 2013, a sister was supposed to be with her husband doing the hokey-low, for the record. I'm still a little bitter, but. See why I can't be a politician. But you have to move out of the way. It's, this is not rocket science, right? Because I also remember being 17 and 15 and going to a student movement thing that happened in Chicago. A lot of you may not know, but we organized Monday boycotts through high schools for the fact that they were not teaching a relevant curriculum in the 60s. I know that sounds so long ago. I love saying that, you know. And
I got you beat on that. So.
You know what I know, but you know, because you know you were my idol then, so you know, let's just, you know how hard this is. So I'm like, I can't help myself. So, and I remember a lot of old people telling us, you know, what we should do, but giving us the space to do it. And they stepped aside, but mentored. I mean, so the key is, it is absolutely imperative that you mentor, and that what I have found for myself is that it just makes me younger because I get the energy back and I get that love back. And what's missing throughout all this conversation, because I haven't heard it at all tonight, so I'm going to say it right now, is that we have to love one another through these processes. And that love gets returned and it feeds off of itself and it grows and it sustains you through the struggle. So the issues that, and then that goes to self-care that you talked about, but the issue, as far as I'm concerned, as an elder now, I get to say that, is I'm going to step aside so that there's space for people to take this to the next level.
You know, I can't agree with you more that about the need to step aside. I just want to give two examples. I mentioned the Black Radical Congress. And one of the things I remember, and Barbara, correct me if I'm wrong about this, and I know Angela was there too, but one of the big frustrations about the BRC then was that there was a youth group within the BRC. And the youth group had people who were like in their mid-20s into their 30s. And there was a way in which the mainstream leadership of those who claimed to be the leaders of BRC did not step aside. They actually didn't, they didn't, it was a sort of sense that, well, this is our organization and you're our sort of, you know.
You're our youth.
Okay, so there's that example where some of the young people at the time actually were invested in this. And I kept saying, well, why don't you just form your own organization? You know, when I gave a, around the same time, we had another group, which was a predominantly white academic labor organization, scholars and activists and artists for social justice, which was supporting the, it was actually supporting the AFL-CIO. And I remember giving a talk, giving the speech at the founding convention and saying, you got a lot of young people here. You should be contesting leadership of this organization. Why are these old people who are older than me then, you know, and I'm already old, right? Why are they running these organizations? And I remember this crazy dude from The Nation, Eric Alterman, writes this attack saying that, oh, Kelly got up there and said young people should run the organization. So there's a sense that what made SNCC so unique is that SNCC was young people who had their own organization with the mentorship of Ella Baker and others. What's great about this generation of young people, like the Dream Defenders and others, young people who don't have to depend on anyone else, don't have to contest power in an organization where people want to relive their glory, right? And that's why I'm so proud and so excited about groups like Dream Defenders, Community Rights Campaign. There's so many organizations that do this. And finally, in terms of intergenerational, because this doesn't really speak to intergenerational work, I have to point to one of my favorite cities in the whole wide world, Detroit. Detroit. Detroit is in this house. And I have to say, you have places like the Freedom Farm and, you know, Myrtle Curtis and Wayne Curtis, who bring young people onto the farm and teach them how to grow food, sustainable food, but in the process, create an intergenerational connection about the relationship between food and social justice. And there's all these examples of that happening in Detroit, and that's just one of my favorite examples. Of course, the Bog Center always has, you know, with Detroit Summer and bringing young people into transforming the city, it's just a really, really exciting place for those kinds of intergenerational connections. Okay.
Well, I'll just say very briefly, I love what both of you said. And I'm gonna remember that. I love the formulation, mentor and step aside. Mentor and step aside. That should be the message to older folks. Really, mentor and step aside.
I'm glad I could give that to you.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I think I've been trying to say that, but you said it so succinctly. And what I want to contribute to this conversation now is that we also have to think about other kinds of hierarchical relationships. It's about subverting the existing hierarchies that we often so take for granted. So we take for granted that in order to show respect to the older folks, us older folks, I think I'm definitely the oldest person maybe in this room, I don't know. Oh no, I see it coming. So Karen said she was 60. Well, I'm 70. 70. No. But that's not my point. My point is that when we think about hierarchical relationships, we also have to think about relationships between workers and academics. And you know, those of us who are academics have to learn how to value. Robin's been talking a lot about knowledge production in other places, in places other than these professionalized institutions. Those of us who do work, say, in the prison abolition movement, have to recognize that we will never succeed if we allow the normalization of the hierarchical relations between people in the free world and people in prison to characterize our work. We have to, and this is not something that we do once. We have to constantly, we have to develop habits of consciousness that allow us to consciously, constantly critique ourselves, because those hierarchies are inscribed in the way we think, in the way we feel. Those hierarchies are epistemological in nature. They're emotional in nature. And if we aren't constantly asking ourselves how we at least become aware of them, we may not be able to get rid of them. We may not be able to purge ourselves of them, but we can certainly develop a habit of consciousness that allows us to notice them, always. And I think that that is the only way we can move productively in the direction of building egalitarian communities, egalitarian relationships, whether it's across generations, across, you know, racial boundaries, across the free world. Exactly.
Right. Okay. On that note, we have two roaming mics. I think Dina and Alice. My goodness. Okay, so I'm gonna be the toughie. Okay, we probably don't have time for all the questions and comments that are in the room, but we're gonna take a few. We'll take a few and then we'll let them respond.
Okay,
give Clemente your attention. Is your mic on? They said they can't hear you.
So I'm wondering your thoughts on this, right? I mean, I'm so incensed in that undocumented young people have been taking incredible risks, but for some reason, the connection right now, particularly black, brown, those Afro-Latinos of African indigenous descent. So I'm just wondering what you think about
that. Okay, we're going to take... To maximize, we're going to take two or three questions. So this is a question on Alice. Aisha. Or.
Hello. Let me try to make this kind of fast.
Yeah.
In thinking about all the workshops that we've attended today and all the talks that I've heard, and Tony Bowles yesterday kind of struck me. He said that capitalism kind of creates this most human. And that we need to start
capturing our desire and transferring our imagination again. And think about dream handlings, pleasures, resistance, and that kind of reminded me of Alice Walker's book, Possessing the Secret of Joy. And at the end of that book, she said that the secret of joy is resistance. So then, think about how resistance is the secret of joy. How do we reconcile resistance as a need for joy with neoliberalism and with what Imani Perry calls the hostile takedown culture?
Okay, thank you. One more. Oh, okay. We're coming. One more over here. We'll take this three, and then we'll take another three.
I want to take this opportunity first to thank you. I'm coming all the way from India, and I want to thank Barbara, UCI, and all the team, because I attended three conferences, two academic and one NGO, and this has been the best. Now, coming to my question, you have talked about issues and powers and hierarchy. I'm thinking, coming from India, how do we connect the dots for a transnational movement? How do we go beyond one issue? Why don't we make all these issues into one necklace?
All right. So you all want to take a stab at those three questions, or one of the three? We had the deportation regime. Yes, the deportation regime, the joy is resistance, and the building a movement.
Yeah, I think you're absolutely right. You know, Obama's now the deporter in chief, as he is called, because under the Obama administration, more people have been deported than under any other. 2 million people. And it's not just because of the Republicans. I think they're also capitulating to the needs of private prison corporations who see immigrant detention as the most profitable dimension of private prison corporations. And it seems to me that this relates also to the question that you were asking about building transnational movements. It's not just here in this country. The immigration issue exists all over the world. And I mean, the thing is that the corporations recognize this as a transnational issue. They recognize it as a transnational mode of producing profit. So why can't we see the importance of building transnational solidarities, movements. There, the sans-papiers in France and in Germany. They're amazing struggles around immigration issues. In South Africa, where the people from Mozambique and Angola are. So it's, and in India also you have immigration issues. In Australia you have immigration issues. In Latin America. So I totally agree with you. We have to figure out, you know, how to harness that strength and how to bring activists together. And we have to recognize that in this country, immigrant rights, the immigrants' rights campaign is the most important civil rights campaign of this period. It is the 21st century civil rights movement. Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, you want to take that?
So I want to talk about the joy of resistance, because I think that has some interesting ties from what we're talking about. First of all, the notion of internationalism is so, it reminds me of first thinking about Pan-Africanism back in the 50s and 60s when we first started talking about how we all communicate across the borders, okay? And I think what's happened is we have the technological tools, because I heard somebody say this the other day, and it's so true. We have more technology in our cell phones than they had to land a man on the moon in 1969, which was my 16th birthday, just, for the record. And, I was bitter about that too, for the record. But the problem is we are so distracted by the fact that the Republicans and the Democrats, I mean, are you kidding me? There's only one party in this country, and it's the party of money. There are two branches. All right? Let's be very clear. Because that's how neoliberalism fools us, that we're distracted into thinking. So the first thing we all have to do is have our mindset around joy, which again, as Cornel West says, is a collective process, it's not individualized. Mm. What neoliberalism tries to do is individualize joy, right. So you get yours, I got mine. And we know that that leads us to nowhere. This is exactly why we're in the struggle right now. But the next step beyond this is making those connections across borders and across issues, because there are always going to be issues that make us uncomfortable. Right? And we have to acknowledge it. We have to say, you know what? I was okay when you were talking about patriarchy and blah, blah, but I'm not okay with the Palestine piece, right? Because I don't know where I fit in that. You know, or I'm all right about this, but I don't know about that. The problem is that it's so easy to focus on a single issue because it's easy for us to become experts on a single issue. It's a lot harder to become experts on the interconnectedness of these issues, because the issues are always going to come down to oppression versus resistance to oppression. So we have to put this in, and I mean, I love the fact that I'm constantly learning things, because sometimes I go in and out of activism, right? Over my last 40 years, I've been in and out of it. And then I come back and it's all kind of new stuff I hadn't even thought about. You know, I was like, wow. You know, I mean, I learned the phrase cis not too long ago. And thank God I taught chemistry, because I understand cis and trans, right? Because that's chemistry, right? I was good with, and it made sense. I didn't have to ask anybody. But then somebody threw some other letters in there on LGBTQI, came in, and A, and I got what? I got something new to learn. So the beauty of the process of activism is that the constant state of evolution, and for those of us that want to teach, teaching is about constantly re-educating yourself. So, I know that. Ooh.
Oh, she should be mayor of Chicago, shouldn't she? Care.
You got your campaign managers right there. Robin's going to weigh in on this. We're going to take one more round of questions, and the hour is getting late.
I was just about to whisper that to you, because Angela said she needs to be mayor. Yeah. Just really quickly, in answer to the question about solidarity, in Angela's talk at the end, she said something very, very important, and that is she wants young people to be able to transcend where they are and understand what's beyond their space. And one of the failures we have is that people don't realize how important India is in the global economy, that India is the largest democracy in the world. It's not anymore. You have a fact, exactly. But see, this is exactly the point, that you have that the fact that you have basically someone who comes out of a fascist, you know, very problematic political past, and this is the regime that's going to be in power. I mean, this is actually this is an international crisis, but people are not paying attention except for those in India. And this is exactly my point. Now, when all those people died in the worst industrial fire and collapse of the buildings and all these different things that happened, this should have been a boycott then of Walmart and all those different companies that make these garments, which goes back to the whole point of like thinking about the quilt differently, that it's sweat labor. Mm-hmm. It's sweated labor, much of it from India. India produces cotton.
But we don't know this, and so part of it is educating our country, educating ourselves to be able to build an intelligent solidarity around what are the movements in support. People know Arundhati Roy, but not a lot of other things and people. Right. Exactly. So this is sort of just the beginnings of that kind of solidarity.
Three last questions from young people. We'll start with Aisha. I should get, is anybody, you all don't want to ask anything over there, huh? Okay. Oh, okay. Okay, brother right over here. And go ahead, Malcolm, you can jump out of the chair. Okay.
All right, pardon the nerves, I'm dealing with some self-assistance.
And I'm going to ask them to be succinct also, okay, even though I love you.
No problem. So this is a common question. Because I respect and love everyone on the stage, this is about accountability. I learn and love from all of you. I am because you are. So here it goes. It's a rhetorical question, but you can answer it if you have an answer. I believe we missed a great opportunity to share and engage in space with one another during this session here. And although what everyone said was great and I learned a lot,
enlightened.
Accessibility and critical engagement is very important in this movement and in the healing that we're doing. So accessibility is complex as we make it. So I'm thinking about street conversations and how, and we bring this up every time, how we take things like this back to the block, right? And I think about how to make academia accessible to the block, but how to make the block accessible to academia. How can we make more bridges, even the language, more accessible? Because I imagine if we had did this on just this event tonight, or some of the workshops tonight on 69th and King Drive, and uptown on the west side, like how many lives just tonight may have been saved? And it's just my imagination, and it's because of you that I think this way. I got a girl, Veronica, she's working on projects like that right now. That's just it. Like, how do we break down the ivory tower? A lot of us do work in our silos and do our organizing, but all the people that's in this space right now, the kind of statement that we could have made tonight on any one of these blocks, from North Side to the West Side to South Shore, like, how can we do that? And when are we around the topic? Miss Karen Lewis, I will vote for you for Megan. You do not have to move out the way. We just got to move around together.
So, two questions. One was, can we get an answer, Miss Lewis? Are you going to run for mayor? We all support you, the whole city of Chicago, get behind you. All we need you to do is say the word. And then my second question was, in this time of organizing, you know, we face a lot of fear. You know, our elders are scared to step outside and talk to our young people. Even as organizers, you know, we're scared to take certain actions, you know, and be radical and revolutionary. How do we overcome this fear, you know, on all levels? You know, what is advice that you can give us so that we can overcome and really transcend to the level of revolutionary, fearless revolutionary?
Thank you.
This is the year kind of said a lot. But I guess I have another question, which is, oftentimes, or like one of the things when I first started becoming an activist when I was like 17, I always wanted to like be a revolutionary like all the time, right? So like I didn't drink any bottled water, and like I didn't like try to breathe cigarette smoke like to the extreme, right? But then that like also made me very crazy, because I was trying to figure out how to be totally away from capitalism and oppression. And a mentor of mine once told me, you know, I guess my question is, how do you, right, as I sit here with Jordan's on, because I know I was going to be here running some days, like, oh, I got to get some fresh shoes. So how do I, like, continue to fight, you know, capitalism and understanding, you know, what you're talking about in India? My mom shops at Walmart. She can't afford to really go anywhere else. But how do I say boycott Walmart? Or, you know, how do we, like, really get to those questions when sometimes I mean, we all have got an Apple product, right? And that's like NSA straight up. And you know what I'm saying? So how do we get away from that? Okay. But be in it.
Great. Thanks.
Oops. Okay. Should I answer?
No, that's okay, Karen. You can answer.
So I wanted to take the question about fear because I think it's
the first question.
The fear question. See, we worked like that. We got it already. We got the, like, because that's Angela Davis and Robin Kelly. Oh, the mayor thing. Oh. So, because it's all tied in. You know, I'm not going to lie to you. I'm afraid of that. Okay? I'm afraid of that. Because I'm afraid that somebody may really vote for me and I'll win and then I have to go do it. Because I've already seen that video. It's this job here. I never thought I would win this election. You know, so I've seen that video. I want to say that fear is paralytic, okay? And it will stop you from taking the next step. I want to explain. I was talking to Angela Davis earlier. And I was telling her that at one point I developed an unnatural phobia of ramps. So if you want to get around Chicago quickly, you need to be able to get on and off ramps. And I was finding all these crazy circuitous routes to get to where I needed to go. And then one day I was late for an appointment and I had to take the ramp off of Lakeshore Drive up 55, and that's a pretty steep ramp. And if you're afraid of ramps, you know, that's not the one you want to take. So, but I didn't have a choice. I had to take this ramp. And what I found was as I pushed my car in that direction, I got angry. Because I said, you will not stop me from doing what I have to do. And that fear started to dissolve. I mean, I literally could physically feel it going away out of my body so that the fear turned into anger and then that anger turned into action. Okay? So fear can be a motivator or it could be a paralytic, right? And at some point you have to make that choice, which direction you want to go. But here's the thing that I'm clear about. It is imperative of us to live our truths. When Angela talked earlier about dreams not having compromises, this is the one thing I know about not being a politician. There are things I can say freely. I can speak my mind freely. I can have my free thoughts. And I don't have to be kind to people. I can just say, but the real key to this though is that you have to move in that righteousness of what you know. And I know that sounds kind of out there, but here's the thing. You cannot allow crazy stuff to go past you and you not comment that was crazy. Right? And that's what we do. That's why all of this neoliberalism stuff is allowed to flourish. Because nobody is standing back saying, that is absolutely insanity. Because people are afraid to lose their jobs, so they're being held hostage. We have not seen real wages climb in the last 30 years while they're destroying unions and telling people how unions are bad for you. Yet when we had unions, there was less of an income gap. And yet here we are going to sit around and having people in Tennessee, was it Tennessee, where the UAW was trying to run a union. And they were like, handcuffing the UAW. Okay, we're going to do that. But here's the deal. If you're going to lose your job, you're going to lose your school, they're going to take it anyway.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So you're going to go down swinging, or you're going to go down with your head down?
But Karen, you just said it. The last thing you said also helps answer that question about fear, and that is the strength in numbers. You know, there's always strength in solidarity and organizing makes a difference. And so if you have a labor movement that is just a shadow of its former self, it's hard. But when you have a powerful labor movement, you could challenge power. Okay, I'm gonna try to address the young woman's question. You know, and of course, you may get mad at me. But this, let me just say this. I actually don't think it's always a matter, accessibility is always a matter of language. I think sometimes what we think of as accessibility is actually deep thought about things that are not really so obvious. And so what ends up happening is that all the things that I've talked about, I talked about to young people in Louisville, you know, and Kate knows this, right? In Louisville, to kids who basically were thrown out of school and were returning through this program. And what I had to do was I had to challenge them to think differently than what they hear. Now, my college students at UCLA, they much prefer to hear a speaker who says the things that they already know. They want to be reinforced. But when I bring speakers who say difficult, challenging things, they have to think. It gives them a headache. Now, I'm not saying it's this. So part of it is that this is not easy to translate. It's not easy to understand because we're all trying to figure it out ourselves. We're not messengers. We're not coming with some high knowledge, passing it down to you to pass on. That's not how it works. These are ideas that are being put out there. You debate with each other about how these ideas play out. Then you debate with the people in your community about how ideas turn out. Not to give them the information, but to struggle with them about how they're thinking about what is the daily impact of this current economy, of current gender relations, that is between men and women, and men and women, and trans people, and gender nonconforming people. These are things that actually happen in the hood. It's not like you were making it up. In other words, this is not a space that should be any significantly different from other spaces where these debates take place. So it's hard work. And if we don't do the hard work, then we're all gonna be sort of waiting for that kind of charismatic figure to give us the answer, right? So, and just one last thing, it's amazing. Almost all the words that I have used, I didn't learn from the academy. I learned from being a member of the Communist Workers' Party, okay, which I was. I learned from being involved in organizations where we were struggling, and some of those folks were factory workers, some of those folks worked in free clinics, some people were hospital workers, and this is the way we try to think about things that are not so obvious. And it's not about finding the right words, so that's helpful too. It's about trying to see the things that you're not meant to see. You're not supposed to see these processes, and you're not supposed to see it. It's hidden from you. So we have to be able to figure out how it works. And if we had all the answers, if I had all the answers, you don't think I would have written that book?
You're done.
You know?
Yeah. And when you asked the question about accessibility, I thought about an experience I had many, many years ago when I was head of the political education program for the Black Panther Party in LA. And we had amazing classes. And I remember this young black man who had never learned how to read and write. We were reading Lenin, State, and Revolution. And he took that text. It's a difficult text. He didn't know how to read, but he got a library. He got a dictionary from the library, and he struggled with that text. It took him, I'll never forget, it took him about 3 weeks to read one page. But he struggled with it. And I think what Robin was saying about intellectual work being work. Communication should be work not only on the part of the person who initiates the idea, but on the person who's on the other side trying to figure it out. And all you have to do is to go into prison and you see that, you know, those brothers and sisters who have time and who know that if they don't learn how to live the life of the mind, they will be destroyed. And very quickly, they learn how to do that work. And so when I'm talking to people, I don't want to dumb down what I'm saying just because I assume, oh, they can't possibly understand. You see what I'm saying? But at the same time, I think it is important for us to be aware of language, and because there are specialized vocabularies that none of us might understand.
I still have to figure out the word hegemony.
Hegemony, okay.
It's hegemony. I've looked it up since I first heard about it. Bell
hooks. Yeah. We'll talk about hegemony. I mean, that's good. We should have a class on hegemony.
Yes.
But can I just say something in response to what's your name, brother? You did such an amazing Malcolm, who did the amazing poem, who asked about how we can resist capitalism when capitalism insinuates itself into our emotions. And yeah, I'm sitting up here with my iPad and I have my iPhone and all of that, and I love it. You know, I do. I mean, but I also am aware of the labor exploitation that goes into producing these things, and especially Apple. We are all implicated in capitalism. We can't get out of capitalism. We can't. No matter what we do, we can never get on the outside. But we can develop a consciousness. We can stop thinking about the things we desire as simply objects of our desire. We can also think about them as creating relations with the people who produce those things. And this is what, you know, Marx wrote about in the first part of Capital, when he wrote about the fetishism of the commodity fetishism. So, yeah, I like your kicks. But you also have to realize that by buying them and wearing them, you have a relationship with the girl, probably girl, who made them in Vietnam or Korea or wherever. And if we learn to think in that way, we subvert the power of capitalism, because capitalism wants us to think only in terms of exchange value. Like we want this thing, so we're supposed to only think about how much it costs. Right? And not about all of the labor that resides within it. Not about all of the people with whom we become connected when we wear these clothes and use these iPads. And I think that if we develop different habits of consciousness, it will put us in a much better position to actually eventually overturn the reign of capitalism in the world.
Thank you, Angela Davis, Robin Kelly, Karen Lewis. I'm gonna make a few quick announcements and then we have a final treat for you. So we're talking about popular education. July 11th through the 16th is the Ella Baker Institute. If you are interested, let us know. September 25th to the 28th at Kalamazoo College is the Arca Center for Social Justice Leadership. Let's Remap the World Without Borders Conference. And then next year, same place, same time, Bandung and beyond, talking about anti-colonialism and empire. Join me one last time, Karen Lewis, Angela Davis, Robin Kelly, and all of you. Give yourselves a hand for being here and being a part of this conversation. Don't leave, don't leave, don't leave. We have a final treat for you. Please don't get up. Sit down, sit down, sit down, sit down, sit down, sit down.
Okay, thanks. So first things first, I also want to recognize Essence McDowell, who coordinated the social media for the conference and did a great job. Thank you so much, Essence. And then also we wanted to give us just a small token of appreciation, one more, to Barbara Ransby. Just a small. So Jay-Z and Yvonne have a little something for you. Thank you. And next up, we have a very special treat.
Yeah, there's one really important question that we have to ask you, and it's a question that FM Supreme always asks, which is, if it's a movement, why aren't we moving? And so, to get us moving, we actually invited four incredible breakdancers from two different crews here in Chicago: Alex Hayashi, Miles Jackson, Jonathan St. Clair, Super In Light, Daniel Brave, Monk Haywood, to actually lead us in our final cipher of this conference. Where are they? There they are. They're going to be over there. So, you guys got to cipher over, maybe. And.
Wait.
Hold on, Dina's gonna play her favorite song instead.
Yeah, we're going.
It is.
Can y'all hear me? If you can hear me, say yeah.
Yeah.
All right, if you all can see us, everybody clap, everybody come over to this side of the room. Everybody make some more noise for yourself for coming out to this beautiful conference. What about this mic? Make some noise for yourself for coming out to this beautiful conference, y'all. This is Smiley Rock from King Crew. Check out Ray J from BMF.
Super In Light, Stick and Move Crew.
Go, go, go.
at the Silver Room. Shuttles are leaving. Let's go to the Silver Room, throw down a little bit. We'll show each other our moves on the Silver Room dance floor. Silver Room, we'll see you there. Shuttles are leaving now. Free transportation there.
Has anyone seen the petitions that were being passed around the room? Has anyone seen the petitions that were going around to free Westmeath order? Petitions, anyone? Volunteers?
It depends.